Hallelujah. Well, praise the Lord this morning, saints. It is Resurrection Sunday. This is the origin of our faith. So I don't know about you, but I'm glad to be here on this side to give him glory, to give him honor, to give him praise. Listen, why don't you help us out this morning and rest on your feet as we come to celebrate our Lord and Savior, the one who got up to set us free. He is risen, and because of that, we have a right to the tree of life. So we come to praise his name. Is that okay? Listen, but just like this. That's it. For the clapping of your hands is just an outward expression of God's goodness. And God, you've been good to us, better than we can ever be to ourselves. The song simply says this. Our Lord, he reigns. There's nobody like our God. Our Lord, he reigns. There's nobody like our God. There's no one like him. Say, our Lord, he reigns. There's nobody like our God. Our Lord, he reigns. Nobody like our God. Who is strong and mighty, seated on the throne. He's high above the heavens. He is God. Say, our Lord, he reigns. There's nobody like our God. Our Lord, he reigns. There's nobody like our God. Do you believe that this morning? Say, our Lord, he reigns. There's nobody like our God. Our Lord, he reigns. There's nobody like our God. Say, who is strong and mighty, seated on the throne. He's high above the heavens. He is God alone. That's it. Say, our Lord, he reigns. There's nobody like our God. Our Lord, he reigns. There's nobody like our God. Our Lord, he reigns. Nobody like our God. Our Lord, he reigns. There's nobody like our God. And so we say, oh, oh, let the redeemed, let the redeemed begin. Say, oh, 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 oh. Say, no one like our God. No one like. Say, oh, 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 oh. Let the redeemed. Say, oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. There's no one like. No one like our God. That's it. If you believe that today, why don't you praise his holy name? There's no one like our God in all the earth. We can search high and search low, but no one can equate to him. Listen, we want to try this part here. Say, nobody like our God. He is Lord.
He is Lord.
Say, nobody like our God.
Lord.
Say, nobody like our God. That's it. Say, he is Lord. Say, nobody like our God. He is Lord. Say, nobody like our God. There's no one like him. Say, he is Lord. Yes, he is. Say, nobody, nobody, no, nobody like our God. Lord, that's it. Why don't you praise him right there? If you know that he's your Lord and Savior, why don't you give him a great praise? But truly, we bless your name, Jesus. We honor you this morning, and there's no one that can equate to you, Father.
Say, nobody like our God.
He is Lord. There's nobody like our God. He is Lord.
He is Lord.
There's nobody like our God. There's no one like him.
Yes, He is Lord.
He is Lord.
Nobody like Jehovah.
Nobody like our God.
He is Lord.
He is Lord.
Say, nobody like our God. Nobody like our God.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory.
forgiven. To know that he endured the worst kind of thing imaginable, and not just to help the people who already loved him. He did it for the people who hated him, the very people who tortured him, and those who weren't even born yet. People learn and understand that despite the worst, Jesus still cares for them. He saved them and gave them a second chance without them ever truly realizing it. Yes, but it wasn't for a long time.
He came back to life?
Sure did. To find out that he rose again from his grave just 3 days after that. That's the real Easter treat. So when you think about it, Easter really isn't about flowers, tourism, fashion, or even candy. It's about the sacrifice that was made on the cross for the betterment of mankind. We owe it all to him, and that's something money can never buy.
Oh,
Great news to the believer that he'll never put more on us than we can bear. Hallelujah. That's great news. It's because of what he's done over 2,000 years ago that we're able to say that we are overcomers through Christ our Lord and Savior by his very blood that was shed on Calvary's cross. We are overcomers. And we all can testify that his blood has done many things for us. It saved us. It rescued us. It delivered us. What has it delivered us from? From the pits of hell. When he got up, the word says that he had all power in his hand. That's great news. That's the origin of the Christian faith. His shed blood, his broken body. But on the third day, he got up. There's a song that we want to render. It says this, overcomer.
Yes, yes. I'm an overcomer by the blood of the Lamb. And by the word of my testimony, overcomer. I'm an overcomer by the blood of the Lamb. And
stand by the word, my testimony.
Listen, people.
He saved me. He rescued me. He delivered me. And he set me free. Ever since I've been saved, I've never been the same. And I can lift my hands and say, thank you for your grace, overcomer.
That's it, I'm an overcomer.
I'm an
overcomer.
By the blood of the Lamb. And by the words of my
testimony,
say overcomer.
That's it. I'm an overcomer.
By the blood of the Lamb. And by the words of my testimony.
Listen, I'll try this again.
Say he saved me. Jesus rescued me. He delivered me. And he set me free. Ever since I've been changed, I've never been the same. And I can lift my hands and say, thank you for your grace, overcomer.
That's it, I'm an overcomer.
I'm an overcomer. By the blood of the Lamb. And by the words of my testimony, say overcomer. I'm an overcomer. By the blood of the Lamb. And by the words of my
testimony. Listen, this is a testimony.
Because he saved me.
That's what he's done for us.
He rescued me. Delivered me, and he set me free. And ever since I've been changed, I've never been the same. And I can lift my hands and say, thank you for your grace. I'm an overcomer. By the blood of the Lamb. And by the words of my
testimony.
Say overcome.
That's it. I'm an overcomer.
I'm an overcomer.
By the blood of the Lamb. And by the words of my
testimony,
say overcomer, more than a conqueror, I'm a winner. The joy of the Lord is my strength. I have dominion. I walk in authority. I've been washed in his blood. Kept by his love, filled with his spirit, and by his stripes I'm healed. I'm free. Yes, Jesus gave me the victory.
Say over.
Oh,
more than a conqueror.
More than a,
I'm a winner.
The joy of the Lord.
I have dominion.
I have
yes, I walk
Say, I walk in his blood.
Say, I've been washed.
I've been washed in his
blood. Kept by his love. I'm filled with his spirit.
And by his stripes, say, I'm healed. I'm free. Yes, Jesus. He gave me the victory.
Say, overcomer. Say,
overcomer.
More than a conqueror.
More than a conqueror.
I'm a winner. Say, the joy of the Lord. It's my strength.
I have dominion. Say, I walk in authority. Say, I've been washed
by his blood. Kept.
God, I'm filled with your spirit, Jesus. And by his stripes, I'm healed, I'm free. Yes, Jesus gave me the victory. Say, overcomer, I'm an overcomer, I'm an overcomer. By the blood of the Lamb, and by the words of my say, overcome, I'm an overcomer, by the blood of the Lamb, and by the words of my
Ah, listen, I don't know about you, but that's the reason the cross was there. He saved me. Not only did he save me, the words say he rescued me. But most of all, he delivered me from my past sins, our sins now, and those to come. The blood has washed it all away. And it's because of what Jesus did for us. We are more than conquerors through our Lord and Savior. We have dominion. We walk in authority. The song says this,
and I've been washed in his blood, kept by his love. I'm filled with his spirit, and by his stripes I'm healed. I'm free. Yes, Jesus gave me the victory. Say, overcomer, I'm an overcomer, I'm an overcomer. By the blood of the Lamb, and by the words of my testimony, say, overcomer, I'm an overcomer, by the blood of the Lamb, by the blood of the Lamb, and by the words of my testimony, overcomer.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen, amen, amen. Come on, give the Lord a praise in this place today. Come on, y'all can do better than that on Resurrection Sunday morning. Give the Lord a praise in this house today, like you know he's worthy to be praised. My. It's a blessing just to be alive, to be in the Lord's house. Happy resurrection to everybody. Amen, 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 amen. We are excited today to celebrate not only the death and the burial, but the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That's why we're here today, to give honor and obeisance to him for his goodness, his kindness, his mercy, his love toward us. Good to see Bishop Richardson back on the organ this morning. Amen, amen, amen. He's all slinged up, but he's still here. Amen. He had rotator cuff surgery just several weeks ago, and that's why he's been out, but he's back at it. He's one-handed, but he's back at it. Amen. Amen. How y'all feeling today? All right, y'all looking all decked out in your yellow and your purple and your green and your white and pink and all of that good stuff. It's good to see y'all on this morning. God is good, isn't he? Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter 28. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Salvation, just by God, born of his goodness. Washed in his blood, this is my story. This is my song. I'm praising my Savior all the day long. Oh, this is my story. This is my song. Look at somebody and tell them, I'm praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission. Perfect delight, yes, vision of rapture. Now burst on my side. Angel descending, bring from above, yes, echoes of mercy, whisper of love. This is my story. This is my song. Check this out. I'm praising my Savior. Yeah. The day long, yeah, this is my story. This is my song. I'm praising my Savior. Oh. strong. Now I have a question for you. Do you have a story? That's personal now. Do you have a song? I've got one more question for you. Are you praising your Savior? Are you praising your Savior? Oh, the day long. Oh, do you have a story? Look at somebody and tell them, I have a story. Do you have a song? Are you praising your Savior? The day long. Glory, 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 glory. Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter 28. I am going to read from the New International Version of Holy Writ. The New International Version of Holy Writ. I'll begin reading at verse 1. If you are there, say, I've got it. We'll begin our reading at verse 1. After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen. Just as he said, come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples he has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you." So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly, Jesus met them. "Greetings," he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see him." See me. I want to talk for a few minutes today from this thought: he's alive. You may be seated. On last night, I was privileged to watch a documentary pertaining to the resurrection of Jesus the Christ. The good news of this documentary is that it was not being done necessarily by the church, neither was it laced with priests and preachers, theologians of the like. But the documentary was being managed by medical doctors, one of whom was a professed atheist prior to his study of the resurrection. Their scientific study of the resurrection had to do with the finding of the shroud that had wrapped his body in death. Shroud was made out of what is called flax, F-L-A-X, flax fiber. They examined that shroud. And upon scrute study of that shroud, it is yet still over in Rome, Italy. Upon scrute study and taking pictures of that shroud, they discovered much of the blood splatters, the dark variances in the shroud, which was atypical of the blood splatters and where his wounds were. Scripture talks to us about the fact that he received 39 lashes, save one, because it was illegal for him to receive more than 40 lashes. So that they would remain within the boundaries of the law, they would always see to it that the prisoner would receive 39 lashes so that they would not have accidentally gone over. But upon scrute study of the shroud, they concluded that this man had received much more than 39 lashes. Because though that was a rule for those who were being crucified, it was not a Roman rule. The Romans had no boundary lines on how they could torture or how they could beat or whip the body of a prisoner who was being crucified. So they discovered that obviously Jesus's body had received much more beating. The study concluded that the shroud that had been found could only have been from the crucifixion of Jesus the Christ. Imprinted in the shroud were the markings of the crown of thorns that had been placed on his head. We hear about that every year during this time, the crown of thorns. And we have often likened it to the crown, the wreath that is placed on the head of a person who is in the Olympics. Once they had won the Olympics, they would receive that crown. But Jesus's crown of thorns was a different kind of crown. It was not as is depicted, the doctors say, in many of the movies and scenes that have been written about Jesus. But the crown that Jesus received comes from a tree or plant over in Jerusalem. And the way it was built was not just around his brow or his head, but they said the way it was built was like a helmet. And so not only did it cover the front of his lobe or his head, but it would go down to a certain point at the nape of his neck. So that's what they saw in the shroud, that not only had he received those thorns around his head, but down to almost the base of his neck. And that helmet of sorts, they replicated it. That helmet of sorts had been crushed down upon his head. You and I know how painful it is just to pick up the stem of a rose. That tree over in Jerusalem is much sturdier, stronger than that of a rose. They built a crown of thorns. It was to mock him. They had already beaten him. That started on Thursday. They had taken him from judgment hall to judgment hall. That had been going on for days. They had stripped him of his raiment and taken his own clothes off of him and placed on him a purple robe. It was not for them to magnify his kingship. It was for them to mock his kingship. Because what they were saying to him was, you are supposed to be the king of the Jews, but look at how we can handle you. You're a nobody. You're a nothing. Now, Jesus was not the first man to be crucified. Let's get that straight. He was not the first man to be crucified. He wasn't even the only man being crucified that day. There were three of them. Jesus happens to be the man in the middle. There was a man on the left. There was a man on the right. This is the distinction of their crucifixions. They were not being crucified like him. The people who'd been crucified before him and with him had never been crucified like him. Never a man in the eyes of the Romans, never had a man had a more heinous crime than he had. First thing they said about him, they lied on him. They say he's a blasphemer because he's around here saying he's God. That he and God are one. That when you've seen me, you've seen the Father. So we're going to get him for that. And they made up all kinds of stuff on him that he had not done and other things he had done, but there was no wrong in the doing of them. He's hanging on this cross, and something else happens to him. They show you exactly in that documentary on last night what I've been preaching to you for almost 30 years. They showed that the nails that went into Jesus' flesh were nails that went into his wrist and not the palm of his hand, because if those nails had been in the palm of his hands, it would not have been able to hold his weight up on the cross. So the only way to nail him was to nail him through the base of his wrist, which meant that they nailed through marrow and bone. Before he was even crucified, he was in excruciating pain. The pain that had to come from the thorns on his head in itself was excruciating. And then the pain that comes from him being nailed in the base of his wrist was excruciating, and then they nailed him in his ankles. Their attempt was to hold him to that cross. This is the good news. We've already been by Good Friday, which was gruesome Friday. But this is the good news. The good news is that the shroud that they are studying, the shroud that they're taking all of this information from, was unearthed without a body. The shroud was left as a witness. The shroud was left as a testimony that he has been here, but he's gone. I promise you, I'm only going to be a few minutes this morning because this is a story that preaches itself. The good news is that the shroud is a reminder of his agony, what we today call the passion of the Christ. The shroud is a reminder of his suffering. The shroud is a reminder of his sacrifice. But the shroud is too a witness to his resurrection. Because the shroud was not found in some place under the earth or in the earth, but the shroud was left on purpose in the place of his burial. Couple of things you need to know about the burial place of Jesus. Number one, his tomb was borrowed. That's the first sign that the tomb was never to be permanent because it was borrowed. And when something is borrowed, especially by Jesus, it has to be given back. I wish I had some help in here. So that's number one. You need to know that before he was ever killed, or rather before he ever died, should I say, before he was ever crucified, the Bible says that this tomb that you and I read about, where Jesus was buried in, from the very beginning, it was borrowed. Joseph of Arimathea. The Bible says, gave them his tomb, his new tomb. You know, folks had insurance long before we came along. Joseph already had his burial planned out and had already had a tomb constructed for himself. And Jesus has died now, nowhere to be buried. And here comes Joseph, and Joseph says, y'all can use my tomb. But now I'm going to need it one day for myself. Y'all can use my tomb, because according to Jesus' prophecy, according to what Isaiah said, according to what the prophets believe, he ain't going to need it long anyhow. So y'all can use my tomb, bury him in my tomb. It's new. Never has a man been laid in my tomb. I got plans to lay in there myself. And the Bible says that's the first thing we need to know about this burial spot. This burial spot is borrowed. But the second thing we need to know about this burial spot is that this burial spot where Jesus is aptly prepared. It is positioned for this moment in time when the women arrive. I've already read that to you in the text, so I'm right here in the text. When the women arrived, they wanted to anoint his body. But the Bible says when they arrived, he was not there. How does the scripture say it? The tomb, the stone, had been rolled away. That's simply stated in text, but it's not as simple as it sounds. The Bible says when they arrived, the stone had been rolled away. But according to the scripture, that stone, a boulder, if you will, let's not get it twisted. When the text says stone, did I see Sister Butler in here today? Where is she? She's in my blind spot. Sister Butler, how you doing, baby? It's good to see you in worship today. Amen, amen, amen. Y'all could have brought her over here to one of these center aisles. She can't see me over there. She want to see her pastor. Y'all roll over here to one of these center aisles. Ain't nobody going to bother her. Amen. Been a long time since we looked at each other. Amen, amen. Come on, y'all give her a hand. Thank God for today. She just made another birthday, too, in February. Amen. I remember. 95. Amen, 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 amen. Y'all better keep praying to make 95. Amen, amen, amen. Listen, the other thing about this tomb is that the stone that is sitting in front of the opening of the tomb is not just sitting there waiting to be rolled away. The tomb has locked in a dead person, never to come out again. So historical data says that in front of the tomb, a ditch has been dug, which literally plays as the key to the tomb. That once that boulder has been rolled in front of the tomb, it is then dropped in place. Nobody can move that boulder. It would literally have to be picked up and moved to the side. But when the women arrived, the Bible says the tomb is open. The stone has been rolled away or to the side. And they have entrance into the tomb. So I think I might tell you this morning that the stone has been lifted and rolled for the purpose of their entrance, not his exit. I'm not going to be long, but it would be nice for y'all to come go with me. You see, the bottom line is that that stone does not have to be moved for Jesus to get out. Because the prophecy is that if you tear this temple down, in 3 days I'll raise it up again. That stone is no impediment for Jesus. In 3 days, he's getting up with or without it moving. The stone is over. I wish I had some help here. The stone is over on the side so you and I can get in. So I want to tell you, don't be amazed that the doctors are able to examine the shroud, because that's why God allowed us in, to see the remains that are in the tomb, but not the remains of his son. You don't need you sitting here this morning listening to me talking about that can't be the shroud. Talking about, I don't know, they just make stuff up. Let me tell you something. God let us in that tomb to get that shroud so that centuries later, all of us could know that Jesus got up that Sunday morning and nobody stole his body. Nobody moved him to another grave. He rose. Look at somebody and testify, yes, he did. If you can go to Egypt and go in a pyramid and dig up an old king of Egypt and get all his gold and jewels out of that pyramid, you can go where Jesus was buried. The problem is, ain't no Jesus there. He rose. Listen, Listen, that stone has been moved away. And the Bible says when they walk in, they see the napkin, the shroud, lying on that cement slab where his body used to lie. It is where he was, but no flesh is in the shroud. He had been wrapped in it. They'd done the best they could to clean his body, but yet there was still blood splatters, blood spots, imprinted in the shroud, showing the bruising, the markings on his body. When the women arrived, they began to cry. The question then comes, who took him? An angel of God shows up. He's sitting outside on the stone. When they come out of there, they're crying. He looks at them. The Bible says he had come like lightning. And the scripture says that he looks at them and says, what y'all crying for? Why seek ye the living among the dead? Now wait a minute now. Why is that question asked and asked in that manner, in that fashion? Why? He asked that question in that manner because there was a time they could have come and found him dead. Yesterday. Like some of us say, yesterday. If they would have got here before this morning, they could have found it. But what the angel is really asking them is this: why y'all come so late looking for a dead man? He told you if you gave him 3 days. I wish I had some help in here. He told you that you better not let him sleep in there for 3 days, because if you let him sleep in there for 3 days, on the third day morning, he was going to resurrect himself. Y'all came too late to find a dead man. You're too late to find him still dead. If you'd have got here a little earlier, You could have found him alive or dead, but it's Sunday morning now. A new week done started. He told you he wasn't gonna let this week come in with him being dead. Yeah. This Sunday morning now, and he wasn't waiting for sunlight either. He ain't no vampire. He wasn't waiting. I wish I had some help here. He wasn't waiting for stuff to be just right. He done rose early this morning. He got up so early that nobody had a chance to cook their breakfast. He got up so early there were no biscuits rising. He got up so early everybody still had sleep in their eyes. Wasn't nobody even up but the women, because they had him on their mind. And I tell you, when you keep Jesus on your mind, God, I wish I had some help in here. I wish we had more Christians today, more folk. I wish I had somebody in here. I wish we had more people who could get excited about Jesus being on your mind, not just when he does something for you, not just when he gives you a new toy, not just when he opens another door, but every day is a day of thanksgiving. You ought to keep him on your mind. Listen, he is so much so on their mind that they go to the grave without an understanding that even if he's there, they can't do nothing about it. they're a bunch of women, they can't pick up that stone. They can't roll that stone away. They are just there with ointment in their hand. They want to anoint his body, they say, for the burial. But that had already been done. You remember when Jesus was in the house? And that girl had that alabaster box of ointment? The Bible calls it precious ointment. When we use that word ointment, it was perfume. As a matter of fact, not only was it perfume, but it served as myrrh in that day and time. And in that day and time, myrrh was used as an embalming fluid for bodies. Jesus was in the house, and that girl was worshiping him, and she dropped the box of ointment on purpose on the floor and broke it. And the ointment started running everywhere. And she took her hands and started smearing it in the ointment, rubbing it on his feet. Then she took her pin out of her hair and let her hair down. Because in that day and time, women did not cut their hair like we do today. Their hair grew and grew and grew because the Bible calls the hair of a woman her crown. So a woman in the presence of a strange man or out on the streets walking in that day and time in Jerusalem would never wear her hair down. She only did that in the house with her husband. That was to show her liberty and her freedom towards him. But whenever she went outside, she would wrap her hair in a bun and pin it to let every other man know I'm spoken for. So in the house that day, that girl disrespectfully to the culture of the day took her hair down at the feet of a strange man, because to her he was not strange. He wasn't a lover, but he was her Jesus. He was about to become her Savior. She took her hair down. The others got angry with her. She said, y'all don't understand what's happening here. This is a moment of worship for me and Jesus. So she took her hair and started wiping Jesus' feet with the ointment that she'd already gotten out of the box. I wish I had help here. Because Jesus said to the rest of the crowd, don't be angry with her, because she is anointing my body for the burial. This ain't no funny business going on. She's getting me ready to die. And let me tell you how serious it was. Let me tell you how serious it was. After she did that, never again does any apostle, disciple, preach a sermon that is any more profound than that girl had done that day through her action. You know how I know that? Jesus said so. Jesus said after that girl got through putting that ointment on his feet and dressing him for the burial, Jesus said, from this day forward, wherever this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached, let what she just did be echoed throughout the world. Everybody ought to know what she just did. Y'all think y'all better than her? Everybody ought to hear about her. What happens on that day on the way to Calvary, going up the Via Della Rosa Road, the way of sorrow it is? Jesus says, she got me ready. So Sunday morning, there is no surprise. I'm done preaching here now. Sunday morning, y'all, there is no surprise. When he gets up out of that grave, though nobody is there, the expectation should be there, but with many of them, it is not. Those women had not accepted the fact he said he was going to get up. That's why they went looking for him. But not only the women, but the disciples were not there, because they were too scared to be there, because they didn't believe he was going to get up. Wasn't nobody there but the soldiers. And they weren't alert. They were asleep. Nobody witnessed the resurrection. Everybody had witnessed the crucifixion. But nobody had witnessed the resurrection, because expectation of him being resurrected was not there. So we can't get upset that nobody was there, because they wasn't there, because they figured when you're dead, you're done. They had the same problem some of y'all got right now. And you haven't said yes to Jesus, because you think when you're dead, you're done. And I come to tell you today, that's not the end of the story. And if I leave you on this Resurrection Sunday thinking that death is the end of something, and that the cemetery is the end of something, and that grave is the end of something, I will do you a disservice. I got to tell you, there's life after this life. I'm not up here for fun and games. I'm not up here just to tickle your fancy or get a paycheck. I'm up here because somebody is on the way to hell, and you need somebody to cry loud. You need somebody to shout it in your hearing and in your heart that Jesus died, but he lives. And one day you're going to die, but you got to live again. And the question is, where will you spend eternity? Resurrection Sunday is not just about Jesus. It's about you and you and you and you and you. Resurrection Sunday is about us. You can't keep celebrating him getting up and you never get up. He lives. He lives. Christ Jesus lives. The day you ask me how I know he lives within my heart. You cannot celebrate his resurrection and you stay dead. At some point or another, my brother, my sister, you have got to say yes to Jesus. Because not saying yes to him is saying no to him. At some point, you've got to make up in your mind that he is the very best thing that has ever happened to your life, and you don't want to live without him. I'm done preaching. I'm done preaching. Listen what he says. Listen what he says. Jesus, as those women are leaving, he approaches them on the way. They don't know who he is. Y'all see that in the text? That fella they thought was the gardener, they didn't know who he was. He says, I tell y'all what y'all do. Y'all go tell my boys, my disciples. I know they wasn't at the crucifixion. They were a bunch of scaredy cats. Wasn't nobody there but John. I know they wasn't there. I know they ran off and left me because they didn't want to turn out like I turned out. But go tell them I said, meet me in Galilee. You tell them I'm gonna be in a house down there, and I'm gonna be waiting on them to show up. You tell them to meet me in Galilee. See, most of us think through reading the scripture that Jesus showed up after them. I think we're wrong. I think he appears in the house after all arrive. But I think he was out somewhere on the street trying to see if they were really going to come. And when all of them got in the house, he walks through the wall and appears unto them. If I had time to really tell this story this morning, if I really had time to tell this story, I'd talk to you about the fact that when Jesus got up Sunday morning, even though none of us were there to see him, and even though all the others who had seen the crucifixion were at home sleeping and still disturbed about his death, the Bible says he didn't get up alone. When he got up, 500 others of the saints got up with him on that Sunday morning out of the graves, people who had already died. And the Bible says they walked the streets of Jerusalem with him. And the Bible goes on to say, and they were seen of many. I'm getting ready to get out of here right now. I said the Bible goes on to say, and they were seen of many. In other words, somebody was on the streets of Jerusalem the day Jesus got up and was walking and saw their mama who had died 10 years ago, saw their daddy who had already died, saw their uncle who had already died, saw their family member, some sister, some brother who had already died. But I wish I had some help here. And that gave validity to the resurrection. The Bible says they were seen of many. They walked the streets with him. They walked with him. And Jesus, when he gets in that house, those disciples are there. He appears in the room. They start looking and marveling at the sight of their resurrected Jesus. Jesus says, don't touch me. Don't touch me. But there's one who's not there. There are actually two who are not there. But there's one who's alive that ain't there. The other one who's not there can't be there. That's Judas. He's already killed himself. But there's another one who's alive that's not there. We don't even read much about him in scripture, but we read about him in this story of the resurrection. His name is Thomas. Didymus. Thomas is not there at the resurrection, at the house showing of Jesus. Thomas is not there, and Jesus leaves out of their presence, and then Thomas shows up late. The other boys are standing around saying, Thomas, you should have been here. Thomas said, what y'all talking about? He said, man, Jesus been here. Thomas said, y'all don't know what you're talking about. Jesus couldn't have been here. He's dead. They buried him on the other day. What do you mean he's been here? He can't be here and in the grave at the same time. They say, Thomas, he got up this morning. He told us that he was going to rise, Thomas, and he got up this, Lord have mercy, and he got up this morning. He got up this morning, and he's alive. Thomas say, I won't believe it. I want to see it with my own eyes. I won't believe it. I'm not going to believe it
except I lay my own eyes on him. They say, well, Thomas, he's already been here and gone. We don't know how you're going to do that. But while Thomas is talking, the Bible says Jesus appears again in the room. Jesus looked at Thomas across the room and said, Thomas, come over here. I didn't give anybody else this privilege, but I see you. You're a hard believer. And I don't want you to be here with me and then leave and then still keep saying, it's not me. So I tell you what you do, Thomas. Give me your hand. And put your hand in my hand. And what I'd like for you to do is feel the nail print of the nail that was in my hand. And then, Thomas, I want you to take your same hand. I want you to flesh it with my side. And tell me what you feel. Don't you feel the mark of the spear that they use to pierce my side? And get a good look, boy. Yeah, look at my brow. Did you remember hearing they put 72 crowns of thorns on my head? Yeah, and then I heard Thomas say, Lord, I believe. Yeah, and then Jesus said, blessed art thou, Simon, blessed art thou, Thomas, because you believe, because you've seen. Yeah, but blessed are those who have not seen, but they gonna still believe. Lord, and the only way for them to believe is to believe by faith. So let me get this straight before I sit down. My brothers and sisters, if you walked in here an unbeliever and you want to leave believing, I'm not asking you to take my story of the Bible's account by face value. I'm asking you to let God change your heart. Because the only way you're going to believe this is by faith. Yeah, by faith we have eternal life. Can I get a witness here? By faith, I believe. If I had not walked the rusty roads of Palestine, if I had not visited Calvary's Hill, if I had not been to the spot in Jerusalem where they say he got up Sunday morning, I still believe. Long before I took that 16-hour flight and landed on the soil of Jerusalem, long before I planted a tree in the red clay of Jerusalem, long before I went to Nazareth and I hung out in Bethlehem, long before I slept in a hotel next to the Sea of Tiberias, I believed when I was just a little boy. I gave the Lord my heart. I gave my daddy my hand. And I was back baptized because I believe. And I'm closing this morning by telling somebody, you can believe even if you weren't there. You can believe if you didn't see it for yourself. I believe in the Grand Canyon, and I've never been there. I believe in certain parts of the Bahamas, and I've never been there. I can believe on Jesus Christ. I believe that there's $1 million somewhere, but it's never been with me. I believe I wish I had a hip here. Somebody has an Aston Martin. It's just not me. But I so do believe, and I want to tell you, I believe in Jesus. He walks with me. He talks with me. He tells me that I am his own. And on Resurrection Sunday, look at your neighbor. Shake your neighbor's hand. Look your neighbor in the eye. Tell your neighbor, I'm a believer. Yes, sir. I'm a believer. Early Sunday morning, early, he jumped up from resurrection ground, shook off his dying shroud, looked up to heaven, and said, all power, yes, sir. All power, yes, sir. I'm closing here. If y'all know you believe, go find somebody. Wrap your arm around them. Tell them, neighbor, living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins away. But rising, he justified, freed me forever. And one day, he's coming back. Oh, what a glorious day. Oh, he lives. He lives. He lives. Christ Jesus lives today. Hey, you can't make me doubt it. I know too much about it. Hey, he lives. He lives. Yeah. Yeah. Ah, he lives.
The doors of the church are open. The marketplace is empty. There's traffic in the streets. The builders too are silent. There's no time to harvest wheat. Busy housewives cease their labor in the courtroom. There's no debate. Do you know why? Because the King is coming. The King is coming. The King is coming. Praise God. Praise God, He's coming, coming for me. Oh, the King is coming. Yes, the King is coming. Oh, praise God. Oh, praise God. Oh, praise God. He's coming. He's coming for me. The doors of the church are open. He's waiting for you with outstretched arms. Saying, whosoever will, let him come. Come on, this is your opportunity. The privilege is yours to say yes to Jesus Christ. Oh, the King is coming. Praise God. Praise God. He's coming, coming for me. Somebody else wants to say yes to Jesus Christ today. I'm going to give you the privilege, the opportunity to say yes to him. If you're that person, come on, come on. From the balcony to the bottom floor, Jesus loves you. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. He's concerned about you. He cares for you. He loves you just like you are. But he loves you too much to leave you like you are. He wants to give you another chance. If you're that person today, come on, come on, come on. This is your time. You say, Pastor, I don't know what to do. All you have to do is walk in this direction. Decide to give your life to Jesus Christ. And let him begin the process of working on you. Of working on you, of working on you. Is there another today? We offer Christ to you. Oh, my sister, bless you, baby, bless you, baby. He will give you brand new life. New life abundantly. Oh, come, just as you are. Come on, come on to Christ. Said one more time, said one more time. Somebody's trying to make a decision for Jesus Christ. We offer Christ to you. We offer Christ to you. Oh, my brother, we offer Christ to you. Oh, my sister, he will give new life abundantly. Oh, come. Just as you are, come on. You may be seated. Come on, give the Lord a praise for these souls today. Good to see y'all today. Amen, amen. Come on, let's thank God for these souls today. I thank God for the Matthew family. They don't know it, but I already consider them members of our church. Amen. We're going to put them on the road today. They've been with us, and thank God for them coming today and wanting to become a part of our ministry. And we're going to make them a part of our family. Amen. 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 And then we thank God today for Sister Moore. She, too, has been coming. Her mother and father, Brother and Sister Jefferson, are here. And I thank God for them. And she's been coming. She says, it's time for me to make this my home, my church home. And I'm happy to have her today sharing with us. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Father, I thank you now for these souls that stand here at the altar. As I lay hands on them, I pray that you'll touch them from the crown of their heads to the soles of their feet. I ask right now in Jesus' name that no weapon formed against them will be able to prosper. I pray now that Satan would be put on notice that they are king's kids. They have been bought with a price. And that price is the blood of the Lamb. So we thank you now for their commitment to the kingdom. We thank you for what you have done to bring them to this point. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, amen. Come on, give God a hand for all of them one more time. Our new members ministry is going to come. You all will follow this lady right here, Sister Moore. Amen. You all will follow her. Come on, God is good, isn't he? Amen, amen, amen. Come on, let's prepare our hearts to give today to honor the Lord with our substance, our tithe, and our offering. Let's honor the Lord with our substance. Those of you who need an envelope, our ushers will assist you with an envelope if you do not already have one. And then those of you who want to give electronically, you'll see the information on the screens on how you can make your tithe, your offering, your liberal gift today through Cash App or Givelify. Amen? Amen, amen, amen. Have you been blessed today? Blessings on you. Listen, Let's prepare to give. Let's honor the Lord with our substance. With the first fruit of all of our increase, we owe it to God. We owe it to God. Thank God for those of our visitors. If you're sharing here today, amen, visiting with us today, sharing with your family, wherever you are here from, we are excited and thankful to have you in worship. Y'all just wave your hand real quick if you're visiting with us today. Amen, amen, amen. God bless you. God bless you. Good to see y'all today. Amen. Cooper's in the house today with his, I see his mother and father sitting over there. And Cooper sitting with his grandmother. Stand up, Cooper. Let the folks see you. We baptized Cooper, Sister Duque's grandson. And I tell you, I've been getting pictures. He's just a swimming and running and, amen, he's doing up some stuff. And so we thank God for them being with us today. They were here Friday, amen, in worship with us on Friday. To all of you, we're grateful to have you visiting with us on this day. All right, let's pray. Father, we thank you now for the seed we're going to sow into good ground. We thank you for making this place good ground. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, on next week, y'all, I wanted us to get by Easter Sunday, Resurrection Sunday. On next Sunday is the what? The first Sunday of April. The first Sunday of April. Next Sunday, we're going to begin the process of pre-orders. We are working to do our book release on the 5th of May, May 5th, which is the first Sunday of May. So this week puts us exactly 1 month out from my new book release. And I want you also to be a part of that. And so I have not been doing a lot of talking about it, but here at church. But I'm going to tell you today, next Sunday, I need you to help us prepare for the book release. I have 1 month, 1 month of advertising, 1 month of talking, 1 month of letting you know what's going to be going on with this new book. We actually have two books in the making, being one that's being completed, but we're about to release my newest book, and every member of our church needs to have it. Now let me say this to you. I'm not just saying every member or each member of our church needs to have it. It has been written with you in mind and yours in mind. Amen? And that is all of our young people, my young adults, my college graduates. Young families, y'all need to have this book. Amen? Y'all need to have this book. It's going to bless your life. Title of the book is Strut Your Stutter. Be you, be great, be determined. Strut your stutter. God has gifted all of us with something, and you should not live all of your life wondering what that is. Say amen, somebody. I want to thank you, of course, for your support of our last book. Termites in the Church did tremendously, but I tell you, this is for you. And you need to put your hands on this book. If you have any teenagers, if you have any young adults, I'm talking to parents, I'm talking to grandparents, they need this book. It's going to be an easy read, and it's going to bless your life. Next Sunday, we're going to begin the process of letting you make your orders for it. And, of course, nationally, I'm going to begin traveling. As a matter of fact, I'm traveling this week. On this week, I'll be in Covington for 3 days, 3 nights. I have been asked to come by the Third Bogachita Missionary Baptist and Educational Association of Louisiana to share with their association and pastors on this week. For 3 days, I'll post it on my site at the Star Light Baptist Church, Pastor Mallory Callahan II. I'll be there three nights, and I've been asked to teach from Termites in the Church. So I'll be teaching three nights. There'll be teaching and preaching, but I'll do the opening each night through teaching. And it's going to be a wonderful, wonderful event. A bunch of pastors, a bunch of laity will be there. And we're going to just go through the book for 3 days and minister to them each night. So the rest of this year as I travel, of course, I'll be traveling with the new book, Strut Your Stutter. But I want every person I pastor to have it in your hands before everybody else. Say amen, somebody. Amen, amen, amen. I want every person to have it here at our church. It's really just going to bless your life. All right, now, Sister Butler, amen. Say hello to us this morning before we leave.
Well, I'm so happy to be here today. It's been a while, but the Lord sees it. I made another birthday. Pastor made his right before me, and I'm 95 years old, and I tell you it's a blessing because the Lord has shown you so many things and so many ways, and to stay and everybody to keep on praying, stay in the Lord's hand because he knows, and he's coming back. I know it. I feel it. Yes, sir. My family says, hold on, and that's what I'm trying to do. My pastor, I've missed it so much. You can look at the TV and see the church, but it's not like being in the church. I love the Lord, you heard my God. And I want to thank you very much.
Love you, baby. Amen. I hope y'all heard her on Facebook. YouTube. Amen. Y'all need to get to church. Amen, amen, amen. All right. I pray that y'all have a blessed day. Sister Horn had a birthday win on Thursday. Happy birthday, Sister Horn. Happy birthday to you. We have another Sister Johnson had a birthday. She's not here this morning, but Sister Johnson had a birthday. Sister Bolden, all right. All right, we got four or five birthdays. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy amen, amen, amen. Blessings on you all. Thank God for all of our preachers, Reverend Tompkins and Reverend Russell, Pastor Sanders II. Thank God for all of them. Where are the baskets going to be given out? Where are our Easter baskets? Here in the sanctuary? All right. All right. Well, they're coming. Oh man, we didn't get those kind of Easter baskets when we were in church. Amen. We have more coming. All right. So after we dismiss, all of our young people are going. I said all of our young people are going to come. Listen, if most of y'all like me by now, my mother used to tell me sometimes I try to feed her certain things. She say, Dale, my teeth ain't what they used to be. I can't eat all that stuff. That's the way I feel now. I want to eat candy sometimes. I say, Lord, I better leave. I'm gonna send my teeth out with that candy if I keep on chewing. Amen. All right, let's stand. Everybody standing. Amen, amen, amen.
I pray that you all have a blessed, blessed, blessed Resurrection Sunday. Our dancers are performing over at Second New God this morning for the 10 o'clock service, from what I've just been informed of. So let's pray. Didn't they do a marvelous job this morning? Didn't our drama ministry do a wonderful job this morning? Amen. Our drama ministry. I tell you, that Brother Brian, he just keep on coming, don't he? He just keep a coming. Amen. Doing a wonderful job. Wonderful job. Amen. Amen. Father, we thank you now. As we leave this place, give us traveling grace. Lead us safely to our destinations, unhurt and unharmed. In Jesus' name, amen. Listen, I want you all to be in prayer. Monica's here this morning. Monica lost her father. We buried him on yesterday.